Okay, everybody good?
Yeah.
Ready, set? Okay. All right, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the press availability for the Majority Coalition of the Alaska House Majority Coalition. I'm Representative Chris Tuck. I'm from Anchorage. I'm the Majority Leader, and I'm joined today by Representative Les Guerra, who's also from Anchorage, and he is our Vice Chair of the Finance Committee, and Representative Ivy Sponholz, also from Anchorage. She's our Chair of the Health and Social Services Committee, and then Representative Zach Fansler from Bethel, who is Co-Chair of the House Committee and Regional Affairs Committee. I do want to talk a little bit about the budget and the budget process as compared, what we did in the House as compared to in the Senate. We did pass a fully funded and responsible budget that was developed in the light of day. We didn't go through early morning hours or late night hours as you've seen in the past. We took 5 days of taking up 134 amendments, but we did pass a fully funded budget over to the Senate. And before that, we incorporated a very robust budget subcommittee process that allowed for us to get our documents up online. Everybody can see what we're reviewing, and made sure that we had a lot of input from the minority and from the public. And so we had a fully formed document that was created as it hit the Finance Committee. But I am a little bit concerned about what the Senate's doing. The Senate Finance Committee did not include any of the details in their education budget and the funding for public education in advance. And so it was really difficult for the public to weigh in on that. There was no numbers to show where their values were within the public education system, and therefore the public, all they can do is just support, talk about the support for education, but not really being able to go into the details. So I think that was an unfair process for the public. And the Senate still continues to tout their 5% cut to public education. And it's really easy to say, hey, we're just gonna do a across the board cut. But when it comes down to looking at those details and finding out, you know, what part of our education system that we're going to allow suffer through these cuts, I think that that was unfair to the public and really not a very good process. Our budget does feature about $62 million in cuts from agency operations from last year. We did a lot to make sure that we protected public safety and public education and private sector jobs as we went through our budgeting process. And we also see that the Senate's still pushing for another $200 million in cuts, and this is after we have cut about $3.4 billion, 44% of our budget we've cut since FY15. And their plan, as they're putting forward, is asking for another $750 million in cuts over the next 3 years. And I don't know how they came up with that number, but I think they're having a very difficult time through their budgeting process right now trying to find those cuts. We believe that we're at the right size of government right now. If you look at the spending levels, and without, we're in actual 2007 spending levels, and then when you take in inflation and you take in the population growth, we're actually back to the 1977 levels of spending. So we have had some flush money coming into the state of Alaska over some years. We were able to invest those into our departments, modernize them, and now it's time to ramp back, and that's exactly what we've done. And I'd like to turn it over to Representative Guerra.
Thank you, Representative Tuck. I've got to say, I'm pretty disappointed right now in what I see coming out of the Senate. I hope that we can reach compromise sooner rather than later. But right now, if you want to hit people while they're down, that's what the Senate is doing. It hits the least privileged. It hits people living on the edge. It offers a welcome mat only to you if you're wealthy, only to you if you're an oil executive. But if you're not an oil executive and you're not wealthy, it takes down Alaska's welcome sign for you. Their budget right now, from what we can see, hits children hard, hits abused children hard, hits neglected children hard. Tells seniors who live in the Pioneer Home that they should be worried. Tells people who may end up homeless coming out of API that there's a higher likelihood they're going to end up homeless. Those are the cuts we see in the Senate budget so far. It tells families that want to raise their children here that they should think about raising their children in another state. After $30 million in education cuts and an announcement that we're going to lose about 100 teachers in Anchorage just this year, They've proposed an education plan that could cause us to lose another 200 or 300 or 400 teachers. At some point, this is going to feed into the recession that Alaska is in right now. We already know from the Institute of Social and Economic Research that after you've already cut the budget by $3.4 billion, as we have, each $100 million in additional cuts, and they're talking about $600 or $700 million over the next few years, their plan is the loss of 6, 7, 8, 9, 10,000 jobs more on top of the 6,000 we lost last year. That's a recipe for extending a recession. You add to that losing your engineers and your doctors and your nurses and your laborers and your construction workers when they don't want to raise their children in schools that are constantly being cut, and it's the perfect storm for the worst recession we've had in 30 years. So I think we can do better. I don't think that you have to pass a cruel budget just to make budget cuts. We've made budget cuts, but we didn't make budget cuts on the backs of abused children. We didn't make budget cuts on the backs of children who deserve an education. We didn't make budget cuts on the backs of seniors. And at some point, you just have to stop. You've got to step out of your sort of character role as Rain Man, where all you're saying is, God, we cut the budget last year. We got to keep cutting the budget, keep cutting the budget. You have to cut the budget smartly. But just saying keep cutting the budget without saying doing it smartly gets you nowhere, so other than to a recession. So right now it's a very disappointing budget, and as you see, their fiscal plan is one that says touch those who can least afford it, hit them, but don't ask the wealthy to chip in. Don't ask the oil industry to chip in. And to me, that's unfortunately the wrong way to go. As Alaskans, we should pull together, but we shouldn't say a fiscal plan and a budget has to hit people living on the edge the hardest. So right now, what I see coming out of the Senate is disappointing.
And Representative Spanholtz.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Tech. So I'm going to pivot a little bit and talk about what's going on in the Health and Social Services Committee this week. There are some major cost drivers in our budget, and one of them that we just have not gotten a hold of quite yet is addiction. And that's why in the House Health and Social Services Committee this afternoon at 3 p.m., we're going to be hearing a presentation from the Alaska Mental Health Trust Authority and the McDowell Group on the cost of alcohol abuse in the state of Alaska. On Thursday, then, we're going to be having our second hearing on the governor's bill to address the ongoing opioid epidemic in the state of Alaska. These are major cost drivers in healthcare and in corrections and in our child abuse, our child protection system, that if we don't get a hold of them, we're going to continue to see our budget grow needlessly when, in fact, we can be finding ways to save people from suffering from addiction as well as reduce costs. So I'm pretty excited about that. Going back to the budget, I want to say that I was really proud to cast a vote for the operating budget, which featured about $82 million in cuts this year. That budget continued to, explore cuts, but also ensures that we are providing essential services that people throughout the state of Alaska really count on. When Alaskans call 911, they expect a trooper, a village public safety officer, or a local police officer to show up. We want to also make sure that our roads continue to be plowed and that we have the kind of public education that's going to ensure that our children are prepared to take care of us and, take the reins of a state when we're ready to move on into retirement and we can't do it anymore. So now we really need to turn to the important other elements of a comprehensive fiscal plan that our coalition organized around. It's time to set ourselves up for some fiscal stability. We've talked, and you've heard me talk before about what experiencing life in the late 80s when we had our first really terrible oil recession after we moved from an income tax based system to an oil tax based system. It was a terrible time for Alaskans. We lost 44,000 people people and net out migration. We had an economic downturn that we suffered from for a decade. It took the university almost two decades to recover from it. Public education was starved for a long time. That's just not the kind of Alaska that we want to have. Our caucus has vision. We know what kind of Alaska we want to live in, and we're prepared to make the hard choices to get there. The other thing I want to point out is that, you know, I've been thinking a lot, and we hear a lot about what Governor Jay Hammond said. Governor Jay Hammond had some I think, prescient remarks as it related to the income tax. He warned us that when we break the connection between the people of Alaska and state spending by eliminating income tax and relying only on oil taxes, that spending would balloon out of control. And that is exactly what happened. We've seen every time oil prices went high, we were spending money like it was going out of style on projects that were not fully vetted, that didn't make sense. And then when the price of oil went low, all of a sudden we couldn't afford important essential services. That's not the kind of Alaska we want to live in, and that's why our caucus is looking to generate revenue from a modest progressive income tax that ensures that everyone pays something for the vital state services that Alaskans are asking for. So I think that, you know, HB 115 connects the people of Alaska in a meaningful way to the services that the state provides that are important to all of us, like public safety, public education, and our transportation system. So I look forward to a lively debate on the floor about HB 115 when it gets there, and I look forward to casting a vote for it. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Representative Sponholz. And then our colleague from Bethel, Representative Zach Fansler.
Well, thank you, and I 100% agree with everything that my fellow coalition members have said. I will also focus on some of the more positive things since I'm the freshman, and I get to feel pride in that we passed out House Bill 106, which is a funding service for Alaska Legal Services Corporation, and I was extremely happy that we did this past Friday. This is something that's going to provide access to the legal system for all Alaskans, and that's really what we want in the end. We want something that is going to safeguard low-income Alaskans' access to the civil justice system, and that's what this bill does by providing a funding mechanism for the future of up to 25% of our court filing fees to be put towards Alaska Legal Services. This is something to me that is very near and dear to my heart. It's something that I believe everyone should have. And really what it does is it provides all Alaskans with access to civil justice. And I could not be prouder to have carried this bill, and could not be prouder to have it passed through the House and now to be taking it across to the Senate. And hopefully continuing there. I think it's important to note that sometimes we talk a lot about the fiscal situation, and obviously that's our largest problem and task that we're working on in this caucus. But also at the same point, there are other things that our caucus is working on, and House Bill 106 is just another example of one of these other tasks that we're doing. Another positive thing that I'm very excited to focus on is the Alaska Innovation Caucus, and I'm very, very proud to be the co-chair of this caucus. This is something that's going to work to harness the potential of technology in Alaska. This is something that's going to move Alaska forward. And this is a caucus that I really believe, especially in this time, is something that's looking towards the good. We're going to get out there, and we're going to find out what's working, what we can do better to diversify our economy. And really, this is a way for us to work across party lines.